daddy works on the railway. In 1842, from Hartlepool, I moved to Crewe, found myself a job to do.
Hello, welcome back to my workshop. I did a demo last night, which frankly was a bit embarrassing. I was at a club, I was working on a small lathe, and I took the wrong gear with me. So the first goblet I was going to do went wrong because I had the wrong chuck. And that threw me completely, and then I put another piece of wood on the lathe, and when I tried to get that up to speed that I was happy, the lathe started walking across the table, so I had to turn it down to below sensible. And yeah, that one, well, I'd lost it by then. That one, it got sort of cut, but not the way I wanted it to be. So this is the first demo I was trying to do, first goblet, and doing it on my lathe, obviously, with the right gear with me. And hopefully all the people that were at the demo last night will accept this as an apology for me going to pieces when things didn't work out. So, it's not quite the same as last night's because I don't want that one. I haven't got the same piece of wood on there, it's a bit bigger. And it's not as pretty. But here we go. I've made that pretty much round. You'd square the end and put a tenon on it. So what I was trying to demonstrate on the first goblet, it was actually the second because I did my 5 minutes goblet to start off with. This was done in 3 minutes 17 seconds and, as usual, it was pants, but it was done. I was trying to demonstrate the wobble chuck. So I know it's into end grain and it's against the logic, but it works. I need a 7mm hole that deep to get me started. So I'd already done this before the demo, save a bit of time, but we'll do it here. Thank you. sure it's clear to keep the hole straight. That bit is waste because it's got a screw hole through it. So let's mark that while we're here. Still absolutely essential. You can get away with having a bit of a screw hole there if you want to. And get the wobble chuck firmly held in the jaws, as opposed to able to twist it by hand, which is what I was trying to do last night. A little bit nerve-wracking for me, but extremely nerve-wracking for the people in the front row. And screw it all up tight. And the objective is to fit this gin glass, which my wife calls a small one, into the end of a wooden stem. So to facilitate that, I chopped off the original glass stem using a Dremel with a diamond cutter, just chopped through it from both sides and it just comes off. Ever so easy to do. Do wear eye protection if you're doing that, there is bits flying around. Tiny little piece of glass, you don't want those in your eyes. So just chop it off about half an inch or so and transfer that measurement to your drill bit in the usual way. And I'll go a little bit beyond it because I'm going to be putting epoxy in here and I want the epoxy to be surrounding the glass and the wood. Giving an insulation layer between the two. I'm in the habit of just guessing this, but it's good practice. Transfer your mark across. So you know where that hole goes. You see the stem fits in there, but the flare at the top of the stem doesn't. No. So I just need to widen the top of that hole to come out into the glass. It's such an insecure connection last night that I didn't do it properly. I went from the outside to the inside to try and keep my pressure towards the headstock to see if anything coming out. But now I've got a good grip, and I'll do it the right way around. So just standard hollowing basically. So that pleases me. The hole is loose around the glass so that the glue can fill it and help the transition between solid and flexible, the wooden glass. And everything fits nicely together. Give it a slight cup up around the edge of the glass. We're good. Now you want the top bit to be straight because you don't want to risk spilling the gin. And then for decorative purposes, I'm going to go a bit beyond that line to about there with a straight piece. Going to use my straight edge round bar skew thingy tool to peel it down. Change of plan, use a skew because it's too slow with this. Working space, cut in with a spindle, just a bit. I was saying last night, you've got to finish this section, because once it goes off centre, you're not going to get back to this. I didn't do sanding properly last night because there's no air filter at the club. And I could put this dust mask on, but the audience isn't wearing one, so that's not really very fair. So I try to avoid sanding on live demos when there's no dust extraction. This is used. I don't want to get it hot while sanding because it will crack. Get micro cracks in it. So I've turned the speed down. I'm going to start at 120 grit, and I was saying last night how I number my abrasives so that if this isn't showing, so you can't see what it is, or in reality, you just pick it up, it's just easier to see a number 1, 2, 3, or 4 on there. The 180 yet, but I'll do it this way. I was going to do this as a complete live, real time, but thinking about it, I wouldn't have done the sanding at a club demo anyway. Without dust extraction is a bad plan, so I'll edit the sanding out. Because nobody wants to watch sanding, apart from Rob. Bit of sanding sealer. I'm using Lubron 1 diluted 50-50-ish. Bit of True Grit. It's just an abrasive paste to sand it from 240 grit upwards. Braid it, sand it, whatever. Now this takes a few minutes, so I'll pause you and just get this done. But in a nutshell, you turn your speed down and start working it in. And I'm going for a Hampshire Sheen high gloss wax. Okay, so this is where things got extremely sketchy last night. Undo these two grub screws and the whole thing can rotate on a cam so it goes off center. That means I no longer have the option of tailstock support. This I could actually move in the chuck even though it was held. It wasn't particularly firm. And I quite like the guy who was sitting in that sort of direction. He looked better without a lump of metal sticking out of his forehead. So I got very nervous and I messed up badly. But be careful where you tool rest goes, because this is now spinning off of center. In fact, as we're here, 5mm off the tool rest there, and 25 off there. So, about 2cm out. It's not massive, but remember, I'm just on a screw on the end. In end grain, never perfectly ideal. Did mention last night, a piece of white card underneath can help you see what you're trying to cut. speed up. To about 1,000-ish. And it's going to be noisy because you're cutting air a lot. Essentially just cutting a cove, I'm going to go a little bit faster. This is going to be a glass, so you're looking at a finger width, is what you're after. You get to see the effect here. Does it show? Yeah, just about. So half of what I did up there has been lost. You need to stop and check because I want to just take it away so that bit's gone. So I need to go back a little bit further. I kind of want to keep a little bit of a curve there, so I don't want to go back too much further. And I'll shape this in a bit further as well for the next one. Shape. I'm going to change to a more rounded end spindle gouge, which will give me a better access to that bit there I want to lose.
It doesn't hurt. A pencil and a tool, let's just show you where it is. So, sand it. Okay, Rob, this bit's for you. But also a little point. This is to be held. You don't want that edge sharp. So, normally I wouldn't take off an edge until I get to sort of 240 grit. But for these, I'll do it with all the grits. Just smooth that edge a little bit. And again, work that edge. Sanding in here is actually perfectly easy. Clean up the dust, have a look at it. You can see I've still got some scratches there, so I'm just going to do a little bit with the grain. Everybody else can fast forward this, Rob, you can slow it down. If you do it three times, I'm using three grits of paper here. So I slow it down and repeat it three times, we've got the whole thing. Have fun. Going to do that corner as well. Most of that will be cut away in a minute. But doesn't hurt to take care of sharp corners while you're there. Right, going back on pulse. Same as the first section. Bit of a sanding sealer, true grit, and Hampshire sheen. Okay, so now we get to cutting the other offset. So just release these two screws again. There is no markings on this for position, but there is a centre mark. So you could easily get a piece of tape and decide how far you want to be either side and put that on the tape and then mark it up on the centre mark to figure it out. I'm just using the two grub screws as my marks, just because I know that kind of works. Once again, check the tool rest position. And away we go again. It's a good plan to slow your lathe down, stand out of the way and hit the start button, and then bring the speed up. Get it where you want it. And let me wet the line. And again, we polished this, but we're going to cut half of it away. This up to about here. Again, you're going for finger width code. and then we'll start working our way back up till we get the shape we want on this edge
just here.
So I want to be coming in from about there. I'm going to use a pencil mark again. And then take the speed up. Sort out that mess down the bottom there, get that smooth, a little bit thinner I think, so a little bit steeper here. you, friend. Especially when things are uneven. And that suits me. Yep. So, sanding again. Okay, so that bit's sanded and polished. Absolutely crucial step. The base has also got to be back to flat. If it isn't, then there's a very good chance the dimmer will get spilt and you'll be in trouble. So I loosen that. I've got a mark, but I also bring my tailstock up and just bring that in to align it as well. Now the glass at the top and the bit where it stands on the table should be in line and it shouldn't spill. And take the speed back down and just start it up, see how that goes. Yep, that's running through top and bottom. Also remember there's a screw thread up to here, so my bottom's got to be above that. So I'm literally just going to shape my bottom pretty much straight off of here and then put a base in and part it off. Your tool rest can go in pretty normally now because everything should be inside it, because you're back to square again. And all should be easy. Apologies, my wife walked in and interrupted the flow after I polished this and I forgot to unpause. However, what I've done is I've gone back to centre. I've got the tailstock in, lined everything up so that the base and the top are parallel. Otherwise, gin will get spilt and that would be a terrible thing. I then started to cut this cove. I'm taking that disc in smaller just because I don't want it to be as big as the base. So it's going in. Not sure how far yet. It might go a bit further yet. We'll see. Might take it all the way into here. But just do another cove and then I'm going to be putting the base in here and go from there. So this edge is going to guide where I feel it's the right place to be. And I think we're pretty much there actually. Might steepen it up a little bit. Thank you. I'll be filing it off about here. Just going to give myself a relief cut. So that I can sand and polish that bottom bit, the underneath. I'm back to sanding. Okay, so that's sanded and polished, time to pile it off. Just mentioned because it's not on camera, I'll take the tail stuff away. Same trick as last night. A bit of scrap from a previously parted off 6mm hole, slot cut on the bandsaw. Standard arbor with a bit of abrasive on it, tighten it up, and that doesn't go anywhere now. And just put that bit. Okay, so what we've got to do now is glue it together. So what I'm using is two-part epoxy. The reason for using epoxy rather than another glue is you actually want a layer of glue. Your hole's got to be a bit oversized. You want a layer of glue between the glass and the wood so that the wood doesn't crush the glass and it shrinks. Which it will do. At some point, probably. I've tried various glues for this. This is the one I like best for it. And it's cheap. It's just come from Lidl. Take your time, try not to get anything on the outside of the wood, on the showing bit. I've not roughened up the glass at all, but I have cleaned it with a bit of meths just to make sure there's no oil in it. I'm also going to coat just the stem part of the glass. Sorry, that's off camera, but it's just doing this bit down here. Give it a bit of a twist as you put it in. Try and get it settle so that there's a ring of glue all the way around. Between the glass and the wood. And then just wait for the magic to happen.